Rosabeth, you are one of my heroes. You're one of the highest clock speed of an individual I've met whenever I talk to you. You have great ideas, and you've been a great coach to me as we launched Ideas in Action. And you legitimized us in our first year. You were one of our first speakers. And I think your talk went to 100,000 views, fastest of any of the other talks. Thanks for coming today.
Thanks, John. I think what you're doing is phenomenal. It's so innovative. It's community-oriented. And the community is not just here physically. The community is the world. Good for you.
Great. So my first question is startups. People aren't going to Goldman Sachs. They're doing startups. And what advice do you have for startups today? You know, is that a good thing? What are the opportunities to kind of make the world a better place? What are the opportunities for innovation, for, you know, making money, startups?
So first of all, I think the entrepreneurial spirit is a fantastic thing, whether it's starting something new, a business venture, a social venture, or it's just being more entrepreneurial wherever you are, in your community, in your workplace, in your company, because that's what enriches the world with new ideas and solves problems. And of course, the world is now presenting, sadly to say, an infinite series of problems to be solved. And if we don't tap the energy and creativity of people who are starting new ventures, we're not going to solve the problems. We'll do the same old thing, and it'll be more and more difficult. So what I tell startups, the make the world a better place is actually the first thing I say, what's your mission? What's your purpose? Why are you doing this? And define it in such a way that it's larger than I just want to make money and cash out early. Because you may change your mind about what you do, and you want to engender goodwill because of the second thing you need, which is great partners. And you're not going to attract great partners if it looks like this is greed, this is self-serving. You need to be thinking about why are we doing this and for whom? Who's the customer? What's the impact? And you know, Uber is now a phenomenon all over the world. And
did you predict that? Did you see that coming, or were you surprised?
I think Uber is meeting such a need. There is such a hunger for on-demand services, and the smartphone is now the way we run nearly everything. And it's not the hardware in vehicles, it's the software that makes a difference. But if you look at something like Uber that's getting in trouble in many parts of the world, they didn't define their purpose from the beginning as, let's fix urban traffic congestion. Instead, we're just a software platform. We have nothing to do with the drivers. That's not sufficient. So startups need some definition of their purpose because they are going to hit bumps in the road. They're going to need the goodwill of the public and of their own customers and employees. And also, I think people are attracted to ventures now that have a sense of purpose. I think we're impatient in the world. We want values.
So a lot of these startups are being led by young CEOs. I don't often see seasoned business people doing startups, but that's not always the case. What are the young CEOs able to do because they're young? What are the young what mistakes are they making because they don't have the experience? What do you think of young CEOs?
So you're asking me that because I believe in the value of experience.
Yep.
And not just the value of youth. So young people bring fresh ideas. They bring incredible energy. I think it's wonderful. But they also need to tap experience and learn from it. You cannot say everything's different now. Nothing mattered that happened before. In fact, Google, which is a giant now, was a startup very recently, and the Google founders, Larry and Sergey, were smart enough to realize as their venture was starting to grow that they needed what's called, in Silicon Valley, adult supervision. That is, they brought in Eric Schmidt, a seasoned executive, to be the CEO, and he mentored Larry, who's now the CEO, and in fact, that was incredibly important. You need a mix. It's not just one generation doing it alone. In fact, I run a leadership program at Harvard for experienced leaders at the top of their professions transitioning to new years of service, and they're often starting ventures, and they have that same exuberance about we can change the world through a new initiative that has social impact.
So you just said you lead a program. So that means there's like an admissions process. People have to present themselves to you. Do you ever take someone that doesn't look so good on paper, but is sort of a you're taking a risk on them because they could be an X factor? Or are you just looking for the top grades and top you know, made the most money?
Well, first of all, when you're talking about people at that stage of life, mm-hmm. we don't use student language.
Yeah.
They are fellows, they have experience, they can be teachers as well as learners. So we're very respectful yeah. of their top positions. Whether we take risks, sure, some risks, but we need some evidence that people could take this learning and knowledge and actually solve some of the world's most challenging problems. Our goal is not simply a new kind of education. Our goal is to deploy a new leadership force that can address the world's most pressing challenges. And so we have people in human rights, environment, technology, education, health.
Great. Thank you for doing that. So you have a book in front of you. You've written many books. So I grew up in New York City, right off of Second Avenue. They were building the Second Avenue subway then. I think they're still building it now. I went to China with a delegation of leaders from Boston right before the Olympics. And, you know, overnight, they were building a subway on the scale of, you know, mythical proportions. So tell us about infrastructure. Tell us about this book, Move. Like, how is this important for our times now?
Well, first of all, this is very incredibly important for America and also other countries that have been falling behind, but America has fallen behind. And it often takes us decades to approve projects, let alone getting them done. And it's not because we don't have the skill, we have the skill. But we have something that's a little different from China. China can simply, the central government can simply take the land, move the peasants, build whatever they want to do, and do it very fast. In America, we're a democracy, and I kind of like that, actually. And so many people...
You're running for president right now.
Many people, I kind of like democracy, and even though it's a pain in the neck that so many people in so many jurisdictions have a say, and in fact, we are bogged down now because we can't get agreement. So I say in Move, America is now not only stuck in traffic... Thank you, John. Stuck in traffic, we are stuck in the past. We're stuck in past assumptions. We have done most of our big infrastructure projects, transportation projects in America based on national defense. We did interstate highways because President Eisenhower wanted to be able to move troops.
Every fifth mile a plane could land, right?
Exactly, and evacuate cities. Mm-hmm. Well, fat chance. Anybody who remembers Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans, you can't evacuate a city mm-hmm. by everybody pouring into cars and looking for the nearest interstate. And then in the 60s, our science and technology education that brought some of the bright young people talking at TEDx right mm-hmm. now, that was the National Defense Education Act. It was in the name of Sputnik and the space race and the Cold War. We need a different sense of national purpose. I think mobility is opportunity, mm-hmm. and we need a sense of purpose that says, let's integrate across all of the ways we get places so that we can help people get where they need to go, get goods where they need to go, get rid of congestion, which partly means fewer cars on the roads. Even though we love our cars in America, we don't anymore love them that much. Mm-hmm. Millennials love their smartphones a lot more than their car, and many don't own cars.
So many of us feel overwhelmed with how hyper-connected we are today. The architecture of the internet, the cloud, Moore's Law, mobile devices. We're getting inundated with information and communication, and my son every minute is asking me for a screen to play a game. What are the opportunities with mobile devices in the cloud, and what are the challenges, do you think, as we kind of go through this period? I kind of liken it to the time when you crank the cars. I mean, I think we're still figuring this out. I mean, we can't be at this pace getting all these emails.
Yeah, I was going to say we're at the cusp of change. Yeah. I mean, an old era is starting to die slowly. A new era is rising. We don't yet have the norms. We don't yet have the culture. For example, bicycles. You ride your bicycle.
Yep.
I've seen you ride your bicycle to my house.
Yep. Yep.
We don't have a bike culture in America. In fact, we have many more fatalities than countries that have many more bicycles on the road because you have to learn norms of how cars interact with bikes. Similarly with digital devices, we need the norms. And what I'm hoping is the next generation of Internet of Things where it's run sort of automatically for us. We don't have to bother with it. We won't be inundated. You can tell your device, leave me alone, and you'll be left alone. And you yet will have all this new functionality of being able to have the lights on at home when you get there, or the heat adjusted correctly and in a way that's green. I mean, if it weren't for current events around the world and so many troubles that we have to pause and mourn for a minute, you know, of terrorism and trouble spots. If it weren't for that, I would be very optimistic about the state of the world because of entrepreneurs with new ideas, starting businesses. Some of my fellows, leadership fellows, have businesses in Africa to improve agricultural production. I mean, we can do things to lift people out of poverty that we've never been able to do before. And I think digital devices definitely will play a role. They will help us train and educate people, just like these videos are getting to people all over the world that can't all get on a plane and come to Boston in any way. Why would they? Because, well, Boston Logan Airport's pretty good, but don't land in LaGuardia or Kennedy.
Great. So thanks for that airline advice. The name of the nonprofit that we formed to put this event on is Ideas in Action. And, you know, the word ideas, a lot of people use it. Sometimes I think it doesn't mean that much. What do you think of that term? We're saying it because we want to bring people together to have experiences together and help spread ideas. And we think it's building a community around to spread ideas is the way to do it.
I think building communities is the way to go. And what I like best about your phrase is not ideas, although people are listening and absorbing. I think it's the action part. I think ideas without action mean very little. I mean, knowledge is not something we keep to ourselves and say, hey, that's wonderful, I know that. I feel there's almost a moral obligation, if you're highly educated, if you have knowledge, to think about how that knowledge can be put to work to make the world a better place, whether it's removing traffic congestion or improving education or, and by the way, traffic is responsible for some bad health outcomes, like $15 billion a year in America because we're breathing polluted air because of traffic congestion. So, but you have an obligation, if you know that, to think about what you might do about it. And I know people are often tired these days, and we do have our entrepreneurs who want to get things done, but a lot of people say, gee, it's daunting, transforming the world. But if we transform the world one new venture at a time, one experiment or new model at a time, one community happening at a time. Ideas in Action started out pretty local and a community, although you did get there on the web the first year too. But the fact is you start and it grows, more and more people get excited, then people do it their way. That's my other advice for startups. Don't expect your initial model to be where it ends up. You have to be flexible, you have to accept change, you have to know you'll get bogged down. I mean, you know Cantor's law, right?
Yep, Cantor's. So last question, and then I want you to say some of your laws. corporation social responsibility, do they go hand in hand? A lot of companies are screwing up and not being very socially responsible. What do you think, if you could be talking to CEOs of Fortune 400s, what do you think they should be thinking about?
So first of all, the difference between cosmetic change and real change. And it's one thing to give away a little money and have the press announcement and get the publicity, but you haven't really changed anything. The harder part is to say, how do our products and services affect people? Can our products and services be a vehicle for change? Can we get involved in causes larger than ourselves? Can we change our business model? PepsiCo is a good example because PepsiCo sells sugar water, and yet PepsiCo is trying to move toward things that are more nutritious and also partnering with
Sponsors of ours, just so to be clear. If they want, we'll talk to them. But
Farmers, they're trying to do things around water. They're trying to do things for sustainable agriculture around potatoes. So a company can do a lot of things at its core that make a difference in the world. And of course, that's very positive. I mean, some of the most transforming things that happen are not a little social responsibility philanthropy on the side. They're the product and service. Apple has changed the world because of the iPhone. that is more transformative than whatever they do in the Apple Foundation.
Just to bring us home, women in business, and what are some of your favorite laws? Your laws.
Women in business are great. We need more of them. My favorite laws. So one is act bigger than you are. And I don't mean by that arrogance. I mean, don't be afraid to claim a big idea and a big space. Another one is it doesn't just take a village to get things done. It takes a cross-sector, multi-stakeholder coalition.
And if you could say that fast backwards, you can get the Audi.
Because that's how you change a community or anything complex. And my final is have courage and persist, because this is Cantor's real law. Everything can look like a failure in the middle. So just keep going and don't give up.
Thank you for being part of our community. Rosabeth Moss Kanter.
Thank you.